அமெரிக்காவுக்கு சென்று படிப்பது எப்படி?
வீட்டில் உள்ள பொருட்கள் திருட்டு போனால் இன்சூரன்ஸில் பணம் கிடைக்குமா?
ஹை ஹீல் சருப்பணிந்து நடந்தால் முதுகுவலி வருமா?
உங்கள் சந்தேகங்களுக்கு ஒவ்வொரு ஞாயிற்றுக்கிழமையும் காலை 11:30 மணிக்கு சன் நியூஸ் தொலைக்காட்சியில் வல்லுநர்கள் பதில் அளிக்கிறார்கள். உங்கள் கடிதங்களை அனுப்ப வேண்டிய முகவரி ஆலோசனை நேரம், சன் நியூஸ் தொலைக்காட்சி, தபால் பெட்டி எண் 1481, சென்னை 618. எங்கள் இமெயில் முகவரி anerum@sunnt.com.
Welcome to News at this hour. I am Sandhya. We'll begin with a look at the headlines.
US-led troops say they are closing in on Baghdad, cluster bomb raids on the Iraqi capital and Basra. At least 7 US soldiers killed as a Black Hawk helicopter is shot down in southern Iraq. Center's interlocutor on Kashmir, NN Vora, meets Advani, finalizes working schedule for talks. Pakistan warns India against preemptive strikes. And Sri Lankan government considering referendum on peace talks.
Now the details. The US-led war in Iraq is now well into its 15th day. The coalition forces are closing in on Baghdad despite some stiff resistance from the Iraqi Republican Guards. Fears of chemical attacks being launched by the Iraqis have been expressed by the coalition. Our correspondent A.S. Paneer Selvan has filed this report from Kuwait.
This is the 15th day of the second Gulf War. After 2 weeks of relentless air campaign, the ground forces of the US-led coalition have made serious inroads into Iraq. I spoke to the senior officials of coalition command in Kuwait. They say the US forces are about 40 kilometers short of Baghdad. They do concede that the Republican guards are putting up a heroic resistance, but the coalition forces are able to penetrate into the forward defense lines. Last night, the American forces destroyed two regiments of the Republican guards, namely Madina and Baghdad. According to these officers, the U.S. ground forces have breached the red line drawn by the Iraqi president around Iraq, at least in three places. Apart from the Iraqi regulars, the U.S.-led forces have to contend with 800-strong suicide bombers who have come into Iraq from various neighboring countries. These irregulars do merge with the civilian population, posing a great logistical problem for the coalition forces. With the forward push towards Baghdad becoming imminent, there is a fear among the coalition forces that the Iraqis might deploy chemical weapons. The commander of the Australian forces, which is part of the US-led coalition, is worried that a chemical warfare might start at any moment. Meanwhile, the Republican guards are reinforced to protect the Baghdad airport. This follows the news of the US forces taking control of two strategically important bridges across River Tigris. At the same time, the fight for the second largest Iraqi city, Basra, is intense. The British forces have surrounded the city. I spoke to Colonel Chris Vernon of the British Army. He said that the capture of Basra may not happen quickly, as they are trying to create a credible intelligence to separate the civilians from the irregular militia. He also denied the media reports that the British are using cluster bombs in the civilian areas in contravention to the international rules. A.S. Paneerselvam reporting for Sun Network from Kuwait.
In the latest from Iraq, U.S. military sources say that troops are now just 10 kilometers away from Baghdad. American troops are reportedly getting ready to fight for control of Baghdad's international airport, which is on the outskirts of the city. With the coalition forces facing little resistance in their advance towards Baghdad, American and British military sources have expressed fears of Iraq using chemical weapons on the troops nearing the capital. Meanwhile, the U.S. has started using the highly controversial and destructive cluster bombs against the Iraqi troops defending Baghdad. British forces near Basra are reportedly using the same weapon. The coalition forces are now preparing to launch a final ground assault on the city of Baghdad. With the war well into its 15th day, U.S. military sources have claimed their troops are now just 10 kilometers away from the capital. Sources said U.S. troops are positioned near Baghdad's international airport and are getting ready to fight for its control. Inside Baghdad, soldiers loyal to the Ba'ath Party are preparing to engage in an urban conflict with the advancing coalition forces. Iraq has warned that the U.S. and British troops will suffer terrible consequences if they enter the city. A large part of the civilian population has been trained in the use of weapons by the military, and they are expected to fight side by side with Iraq's regular forces.
We are expecting, or at least planning for, a very difficult fight ahead. We are not expecting to drive into Baghdad suddenly and seize it in a coup de main or anything like that. So in regard to that, we are paying great attention to their ability to defend on the ground. They may just suddenly be effective on the ground. Additionally, their ability...
As the bombing of Baghdad continues, hospitals in the city are full of civilians injured in the attacks. Doctors at the city's Kindi Hospital have already admitted several Iraqis who were injured in the coalition's latest round of bombings, where the highly destructive cluster bombs were used.
We received about 5 cases injured by a bomb, which was cluster bombs. Some of them sustained severe fractures in the upper limbs and lower limbs.
Meanwhile, in the southern city of Basra, British forces have taken control of a factory complex used by the Iraqi militia. The factory was reportedly used for firing mortars on the British troops trying to take control of the city. Iraqi soldiers and members of the Ba'ath Party are still engaged in fighting with the British in many parts of Iraq's second largest city. A U.S. Army Black Hawk helicopter has been shot down in southern Iraq, killing 7 of the 11 soldiers on board. Pentagon officials said the casualty number is yet to be confirmed and said search and rescue personnel are at the scene where the craft came down. Officials said the other 4 soldiers on board the Black Hawk sustained injuries and have been rescued. On Wednesday, a fighter aircraft of the U.S. Navy was shot down over southern Iraq by a surface-to-air missile.
the helicopter was downed by small arms fire near Karbala, the site of fierce fighting between the Army's 3rd Infantry Division and Iraqi troops, including the Republican Guard forces. The Black Hawk is the second U.S. helicopter lost in combat since U.S. and British forces invaded Iraq 2 weeks ago. An Apache gunship went down last week and its two crew members were captured by Iraqi forces. Earlier, a Navy fighter jet went down in Iraq just before midnight on Wednesday. U.S. defense officials said its forces are taking intense efforts to find and rescue the pilot. The twin-engine aircraft was heavily used during the first Gulf War and has flown several sorties during the current war in Iraq.
In the wake of several cases of severe acute respiratory syndrome being reported from Southeast Asian nations and Canada, hospitals in New Delhi are gearing up for any contingency in case of attack such a virus on the nation's capital. The Union Health Ministry has asked all international airports and seaports to screen passengers coming from the 15 identified countries where the pneumonia is prevalent.
Hospital authorities in New Delhi said there was no cause for panic on SARS in the country. All India Institute of Medical Sciences is one of the three hospitals identified in the capital to treat cases of the killer epidemic. The other two are the Safdarjung Hospital and Ram Manohar Lohia Hospital. AIIMS Director P.K. Dave said the institute is fully geared up to face any emergency.
I don't think there is any cause for panic. I think, but whenever there is such an exigency, we have to be prepared. And at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, we are aware of these health problems and we react to such exigencies as and when needed.
Dave also said various diagnostic procedures have been identified to track the dreaded disease.
The diagnosis is based on different things. The diagnosis is by imaging, diagnosis is by bacteriological examination, virological examinations. And there are many modalities of diagnosis. Basically, the diagnosis would be made, the first thing would be on the basis of clinical evidence. And then, of course, we apply all the diagnostic tests.
As a precautionary measure, all Indian missions abroad have been asked to screen visa seekers for possible strains of the killer virus. Airline crew have been alerted to look out for any passengers with high fever and cough-related symptoms. Passengers bound for India are being asked to fill up an additional pro forma on their medical history and travel details during the immediate past.
The centre's interlocutor for Jammu and Kashmir, N.N. Vora, met Deputy Prime Minister L.K. Advani and finalised a working schedule for talks with political parties in the state. Union Home Secretary N. Gopalswamy and other senior officials of the ministry also took part in today's talks. Prime Minister Vajpayee is scheduled to undertake a two-day visit to Jammu and Kashmir on the 18th of April, following which Vora will visit the state on the 20th of April for talks.
Speaking after holding discussions with Advani, Vora said he would hold talks with all political parties in Jammu and Kashmir, starting with the National Conference, indicating that no formal offer will be extended to any separatist group, including the Hurriyat Conference, for talks. Vora said the information will come out in the media. He, however, said a meeting will be held with all concerned parties in accordance with the schedule. Meanwhile, the National Conference President Omar Abdullah said in Srinagar that he will plead for the restoration of autonomy to Jammu and Kashmir during his talks with Vora. Abdullah claimed autonomy is the only solution to the Kashmir issue. He added that his party would not settle for anything less, nor would it seek anything more, like the pre-1947 status.
British Foreign Secretary Jack Straw has expressed grave concern over the increasing evidence of infiltration across the line of control. He said Britain wanted to see Islamabad acting to put an end to all kinds of militancy and terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir. At the same time, he sought a beginning of the political process that would restore peace in the state.
Speaking of some recent terrible atrocities, apparently a reference to the Nandimarg massacre of Pandits, British Foreign Secretary Jack Straw asked Pakistan to do everything it can to stop terrorist infiltration into Jammu and Kashmir. He urged both India and Pakistan to start a dialogue to ensure the safety of people on both sides of the line of control. Straw said the joint statement on Kashmir he had issued with U.S. Secretary of State Colin Powell in Camp David followed increasing evidence of infiltration across the LOC.
Sri Lankan Constitutional Affairs Minister G.L. Peiris has said his government is considering a referendum on the Norwegian-backed peace talks with rebel LTTE. Peiris' remarks come at a time when the Sri Lankan government and the Tigers are moving to yet another round of talks slated for this month end in Thailand.
Sri Lanka's Constitutional Affairs Minister G.L. Peiris told reporters in Colombo that his government is earnestly considering the question of a referendum on the peace talks with the LTTE. He said it had been suggested that it would be useful to hold a referendum on a peace bill setting out steps to carry forward peace talks and to prepare a new constitution. Peiris also said Sri Lanka hoped India would participate in the crucial aid-related meeting called by the United States on the 14th of this month in Washington to help support the peace efforts.
Pakistan has warned India that it would give a suitable reply if New Delhi launched any preemptive strike. Pakistan Foreign Office spokesperson Aziz Ahmed Khan said Islamabad wants a peaceful resolution of all issues, including Kashmir. He also warned that Pakistan is ready to give a fitting reply to any aggression against his territory. Khan was reacting to External Affairs Minister Yashwant Sinha's remarks that India has a better case for preemptive action against Pakistan than the United States had against Iraq. Khan also denied the Indian charge of cross-border terrorism and reiterated the demand for UN observers to be posted along the line of control to verify the charges. A two-day national executive meeting of the BJP begins in Indore tomorrow. On the agenda is the party's strategy for the coming elections in Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan and Delhi. Party general secretaries met under the chairmanship of party president Venkaiah Naidu and finalized the agenda. The BJP's setback in the Himachal Pradesh poll is also expected to figure in the discussions. Prime Minister Vajpayee, Deputy Prime Minister L.K. Advani and several cabinet ministers are slated to take part in the deliberations.
In Tamil Nadu, at least 6 people killed in a road accident near Namakkal. President Abdul Kalam presents Padma Awards for distinguished service in different fields.
Welcome back to some more news. At least 6 people were killed when a van and a tanker lorry collided head-on near Namakkal in Tamil Nadu. 6 others have been injured. All of them hail from Viralipatti village on the Namakkal-Tiruchirappalli highway.
Villagers of a particular community were on their way to hunt rabbits when the accident occurred. The van in which they were travelling collided with an LPG cylinder-laden tanker lorry. 6 people died on the spot. 6 other injured have been admitted at the Namakkal Government Hospital. Some hunting dogs which were taken along to hunt rabbits were also killed in the accident.
President APJ Abdul Kalam presented Padma Bhushan and Padma Shri awards to distinguished persons from different walks of life in New Delhi. The recipients include famous film personalities Nasiruddin Shah, Amir Khan, cricketer and international umpire S. Venkatraghavan and noted writer O.V. Vijayan.
At a ceremony held in the Darbar Hall of the Rashtrapati Bhavan, President Abdul Kalam presented the Padma Vibhushan Award to 83-year-old Ayurveda Vaidya Brahaspati Dev Tribhuna. Padma Vibhushan was also presented to Balram Nanda for Literature and Education and noted Odissi dancer Sonal Mansingh. Nasiruddin Shah and literator O.V. Vijayan were honoured with the Padma Bhushan and actor-director Amir Khan got the Padma Shri. Cricketer turned test umpire S. Venkatraghavan and athlete Jyotirmoy Sikdar were awarded the Padma Shri. A delighted Amir Khan said,
"Well, an award which I have respect for, regard for, and value for are the ones that I, you know, attend and show respect and endorse with my presence." मुझे शायद मुझे एक्चुअली पता नहीं है क्यों मुझे क्या क्या वजह हैं इसके पीछे मिलने के बट आई एम श्योर इट कैन नॉट बी एनी वन फिल्म आई एम श्योर इट हैज टू बी व्हाट वर्क आई हैव डन टिल नाउ
फॉर द सेकंड ईयर इन अ रो द भारत रत्न हैज नॉट बीन अवार्डेड ऑल टुगेदर 91 पद्म अवार्ड्स इंक्लूडिंग 32 पद्म भूषण एंड 55 पद्मश्रीज वर अनाउंस्ड दिस ईयर
Eight new judges have been sworn in for the Madras High Court today, increasing the number of judges to 37. Chief Justice B. Subhashan Reddy administered the oath of office at a simple function in the court premises. With these appointments, there are five more judges' positions to be filled in the Madras High Court, which has sanctioned strength of 42.
President APJ Abdul Kalam on the 29th of March announced the appointment of eight new additional judges for the Madras High Court. The first judge to be sworn in was R. Bhanumati, who had given two life imprisonments in the Swami Premananda case. S. Ashok Kumar, judge of the Krishnagiri Sessions Court, was the next to take oath. He was followed by S. K. Krishnan, T. V. Masalamani, A. R. Ramalingam, S. Sardar Zakaria Hussain, M. Tanikachalam, and S. R. Singaravela. Advocate General N.R. Chandran welcomed the new judges and various lawyers association felicitated them. The new judges thanked the bench and the bar and sought their full cooperation to discharge their duties.
The Tamil Nadu government has decided to expand the treatment on payment scheme to all government hospitals in the state. The state government has also announced opening a new medical college in Dindigul.
Speaking in the State Assembly, Tamil Nadu Health Minister S. Semmelai announced that the government has decided to expand the treatment on payment scheme to all government hospitals in the state. The scheme is currently available only in a couple of government hospitals. The minister also claimed that the scheme introduced in government maternity hospitals has received good response. He also said the government has decided to appoint 500 doctors to primary health centers in the state. In a bid to stem the growth of sexually transmitted diseases, the government has decided to sell condoms through Russian shops, the minister added.
The Marxist members in Tamil Nadu Assembly today walked out of the house protesting the speaker not allowing them to raise the issue of Vellayan's arrest. Police arrested Tamil Nadu Traders Federation President D. Vellayan on Tuesday midnight, charging him with intimidating a hotelier in Chennai.
Vellayan's arrest echoed in the house with Deputy Leader of Opposition Durai Murugan and Congress Legislature Party Leader S.R. Balasubramaniam raising the matter during Zero Hour. But the Speaker Kalimuthu disallowed the members from raising the issue. He said the issue should be taken up later. CPM member Karunakaran again tried to raise the issue but the Speaker firmly disallowed it. Protesting this, CPM MLAs walked out of the Assembly.
Vellayan and other office bearers of the Traders Association were taken into custody in a midnight arrest. We want the government to release them. When we try to bring it to the notice of the government says it will take up the issue after 2 days. By this, the government is justifying keeping them in custody for another 2 days. This is an anti-democratic act.
Meanwhile, traders continue their shutdown in Dindigul, Parani and Pudukote demanding the release of Vellayan and other office bearers. Traders are also undertaking fasts in places like Ambattur in Chennai.
With the lorry strike well into its third day, goods traffic in and out of Chennai continues to be affected severely. A large number of lorries are parked in Vandalur, Poonamalli and Urappakkam along the East Coast Road.
Protesting the ban on daytime entry of lorries into Chennai city, lorries are staying off the road since April 1st. Chennai Lorry Owners Association President Sukumar said the strike will continue till the state government lifts the ban. Lorry owners in Trichurappalli also took out a rally expressing solidarity with the striking lorry owners. After the rally, they demonstrated in front of the collectorate to press their demands.
Eight Chennai lawyers have moved the Madras High Court for a CBI probe into the Tamil Nadu Liberation Army activist Rajaram's death on the 25th of March. They allege that police reports of an encounter death were incredible and prayed the court to restrain the Chennai police from any role in the investigation.
According to the police, Tamil Liberation Army activist Rajaram was killed in an encounter with a group which tried to rescue the leader from their custody on March 25th. Another extremist, Saravanan, was also killed in the incident in Kotturpuram, which took place when Rajaram was being taken to prison from a court hearing. Rajaram's lawyers and some others have filed a petition in the High Court demanding a CBI inquiry. They said from their inquiries they found that the people of the area had heard or seen nothing of the encounter, even though it was supposed to have taken place during peak hour. The lawyers also want the Chennai police to be held back from any involvement in the investigation.
China announces that killer pneumonia disease is under control. And the second round of India-New Zealand Davis Cup tie begins in Kolkata tomorrow.
இன்பம் என்றும் தூரம் இல்லை அன்பு கந்தவானம் எல்லையே வாழ்வில் ஒன்றும் நிலையாயில்லை வாழும் வரை நினைப்பதும் இல்லை ஆசைக்கென்றும் எல்லை இல்லையே பணம் கண்டால் உறவாயில்லை உடன் பிறந்தால் பரவாயில்லை நல்ல உள்ளம் எங்கும் இல்லையே நல்லதுக்கு காலம் இல்லையே
From the world scene, after 46 victims and about 1,200 patients, China has announced that the severe acute respiratory syndrome is under control. But many Beijingers have taken to traditional Chinese medicine in search of the elusive cure for the killer disease. Yes, now from the sports world, the Indian Davis Cup team is all charged up to take on New Zealand in the Asia-Oceania Group 1 second round tie, beginning in Kolkata tomorrow. Mahesh Bhupathi will once again partner Leander Paes to play against New Zealand on Saturday to bolster the Indian challenge.
In the opening singles match, India's star campaigner Leander Paes will play New Zealand's Mark Nielsen at the South Club. Rohan Bopanna will play the second singles later in the day against Alistair Hunt. On Saturday, Paes teams up with Mahesh Bhupathi for the doubles against Nielsen and Hunt. In the reverse singles on Sunday, Bopanna will play Nielsen in the first match and Paes takes on Hunt in the final match of the rubber. India's non-playing captain Ramesh Krishnan said he is more than happy with the draw as it enables Paes to get some rest in between his matches.
Time now for a recap of the headlines.
US-led troops say they are closing in on Baghdad, cluster bomb raids on the Iraqi capital and Basra. At least seven US soldiers killed as a Black Hawk helicopter is shot down in southern Iraq. Center's interlocutor on Kashmir, NN Vora, meets Advani, finalizes working schedule for talks. Pakistan warns India against preemptive strikes. And Sri Lankan government considering referendum on peace talks.
Well, that's all we have for this edition. Thanks for joining us.
AVM's Mangai Choice, sponsored by Amritanjan Dr. Sugam, Gold Million Sunflower Oil, CSC Sat 2003, Discount Soap, She Sanitary